Amaina, same thing. Again, I'll ask 4 questions from you and you have to answer. Okay. Amaina, tell me which are the vitamins synthesized in our large intestine? Tell me the name of vitamin which are synthesized in our body in large intestine.
A and B.
A and B. Hey, come on. Yeah, not A and B. A and B. No. Tell me the name of enzyme which are synthesized. I'll give you a hint. They are synthesized in our small intestine with the help of bacteria. Vitamin B and K. Yes, we discussed. Okay, no issue. I'll ask you some more question. The enzyme which is responsible for the digestion of milk protein. Tell me the name of enzyme.
Prorenin.
Yes, renin. Very good. One correct answer. Now, the third question. Listen carefully. What is the pH value of bile in liver? Very simple question. What is the pH value of bile in liver?
8.6.
Very good. Very good. Excellent. Okay. Again, one last question. What is the function of bile? Tell me. What is the function of bile? Is Amaina? Bile juice or bile salt? What is the function of bile salt or bile juice? Come on. Anyone else?
So, emulsification of fats and carbohydrates.
Very good. Excellent. All right.
Sir, plus one?
Yeah, plus one. Definitely, I'll give you one more mark. So, you are able to compensate that one. Okay, plus one.
Fine. Thank you, sir.
Welcome. So, next is Meenakshi. Next is Meenakshi. Meenakshi, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Enjoy this session. Don't be in panic, right? This is a brainstorming session. Like this session is for you. I want you to push to study more and more, right? To check the level, check the level of water. Okay. So, which animal do not secrete saliva?
Herbivorous.
Yes.
Herbivorous.
Very good. Very good. Excellent. Great. You got 1 marks. Okay. So, what is the function of trypsin? What is the function of trypsin?
Protein.
Tell me, yes. Protein. protein digestion. You'll get half marks for this question. You're not confident. Okay, next. So, absorption of glucose and galactose takes place by the process of active, passive, facilitated by diffusion. Four options. Active, passive, facilitated, diffusion. Come on, tell me. You have four options. I have given four options as well.
Active.
Very good. Active. Okay. Last question. What is the function of tylin? What is the function of tylin? Anyone else?
Sir, hydrolyzation of starch, it's in salivary amylase.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, and it breaks starch into?
Starch into hydrolyzation of starch, sir.
That's right. I have told you that what are the component in which it breaks starch into? Glucose and galactose.
Glucose and yes.
I'll give you half marks, champ.
Okay.
Fine, Meenakshi. So, okay. Now, Meenakshi, you need to revise more, right?
Yes.
Okay. I'll again take Viva for the same chapter. Okay. Now, so who's the next one? Okay. Majia, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine, great. So, I'll ask you easy question from you, okay?
Okay.
So, I have told you that humans are thicodont. What does mean by thicodont? Thicodont, diphyodont, thicodont.
Like the teeth are embedded in the sockets.
Very good.
Of the jawbone.
Very good. Very good. Be quick. Okay. Good.
Sorry.
Okay. So the next question. A part of the stomach remains filled with gas. What is the name of that part of stomach? Part of the stomach which remains filled with gas. What is the name of that part?
It is called large intestine. No, no, not large intestine.
I'll give you four options. That is a hint for you. Cardiac, fundus, body, pyloric. These are the four parts of the stomach. Cardiac, fundus, body, and pylori. Out of these four, one remains filled with gas. Anyone else?
The fundus.
Very good. Samara, you'll get one more mark. So I'll give you. Fine. Okay. So, third question for you. Okay, Mazia?
Okay.
Try to tell all the question now. Again, there will be an easy question for you. This is very easy. So I have to search. Tell me the function of lipase. Lipase.
Lipase helps in digesting fats.
Very good, excellent. And last question from you. What is the function of, or we, you can say, what is the name of the cell which secretes HCl from stomach? Name of the cells which secrete HCl from stomach.
So it is called.
I will give you four. I will give you four options.
Okay.
Mucus cell, chief cell, oxyntic cell, and G cells.
Sir, oxyntic cell.
Very good. Excellent. Fine. Great. So, who's the next one? Alvia. Alvia, are you ready? Alvia?
Yes.
Great. So, my first question. Tell me, please listen carefully. Tell me the number of salivary gland which are found in our body, our digestive system. Number of salivary gland. Tell me.
Three.
I repeat it again. Tell me the number of salivary gland found in our body. Anyone else?
One.
There are six.
So, three pairs.
Three pairs.
Yeah, three pairs. That's why I was repeating again and again.
Yes.
You missed one question. So, Shishtisham, you have got 3.5. So, the test is for only four. Like those who have missed.
Sir, so remove the half and put one, sir.
Yeah. I'll do that. I'll do that. You deserve that. Yeah. So you have got 4 out of 4. So again, second question. Very simple question. Tell me the function of HCl.
Sorry, sir.
What is the function of HCl? Function of HCl. Come on, tell me. What is the function of HCl?
To,
yes, Alvia.
To help your body to break down, digest, and absorb nutrients and make an acidic environment.
Okay, make an acidic environment. One is correct. The one logic. And else, other than making an acidic environment?
Break down protein.
No, no, no. It do not break down anything. It do not help in digestion. So you'll get half marks for this.
Oh, it also kills yes. bacteria.
Very good, very good. That is the correct. Okay. Narrow scape. So, great. My next question. What is the function of gallbladder? What is the function of
gallbladder? To store bile juice.
Very good. So does it secrete something or not? Does it itself secrete something? No? Okay, no issue. Anyone else? Does it secrete something? No issue. Tell me name of enzyme which digest protein. You have to tell me name of any enzyme which digest protein.
Trypsin.
Very good. Trypsin. Good. Great. Good job. Okay. And the last one is Atif. Atif, are you ready? Yes, Atif?
Yes.
Okay, great. So, again, I'll ask a simple question from you. Humans are diphyodont. What does mean by diphyodont?
Sir, we have two sets of teeth.
Very good. Two sets of teeth. Like the name of teeth?
Sorry, sir?
The name of those sets?
Sir, milk teeth and permanent teeth.
Very good. Excellent. Very good. Next. Again, one more question from a dental formula. The teeth which are not found in infants or kids?
Molars.
Molars. Very good. Good. Excellent. Which is the longest part of intestine? Tell me along with the length. What is the longest part of intestine?
Sir, duodenum.
Hey, come on. That is the shortest. That is of only 25 centimeters.
So it's ileum, ileum, ileum.
Ileum, good. So you have taken two attempts. I'll give you half marks. Right? Okay. Okay, be precise. Last question for you. So you are performing very good. I'm impressed. So don't disappoint me. Answer correctly. Okay, Atif? So,
okay, sir.
Okay. So my next question is that what is succus entericus? The succus entericus term is used for what is succus entericus? You can tell it is secreted from succus entericus is the name of some enzyme or some group of enzyme.
No, sir, I'm not sure.
Anyone else? Samaira? Want to try?
Don't know, sir.
No. Anyone else? Alvia, Maziha, Minashi, anyone else can try if you want. You can get one question, one marks. Okay. Hey, come on, it's a very easy question.
So the question?
What is Succus Intricus? This is the name of some enzyme. This is other name of some enzyme. Come on, guys. I have told you intestinal juice is also known as Succus Intricus. Easy question. Okay, great. So that's it for your viva. And all of you performed well. And what you need to do that, what I expect from you and what is missing over here. During this our conversation, what I have observed that you have studied well, but you need to brush up more. You have already done your 80% job. But the rest of the 20%, that is revision and brush up. That is very important. It will help you out, right? And believe on me, if you will hard work, what I have observed that generally, even in here, like offline classes, online classes, everywhere. So what actually the student do in 11th class, they just remain lazy. So they hardly pay more attention and they are not that much laborious. But after the 12th, what they do, this become a Herculean task for them to prepare animal physiology and plant physiology. And they get stuck. They again give 1 year to revise all those concepts. So don't waste this year. Okay. So revise all the concept only here so that after the 12th class, directly you appear in your medical examination. You need not to prepare extra for extra one year, right? So brush up these questions. You will get all these questions in your medical examination. You will be able to attempt all the questions, whatever we have studied, right? So should we start with the respiration part?
Yes.
Let's start, right? Meenakshi, I have got your question paper, right? We'll discuss some other day because it's already, we have spent almost 35 minutes, right? So I want to like teach some today as well. So we'll discuss in next class, fine? I have got the question paper, like Niskar ji have shared with me. So we'll discuss the same paper in next class, right? And till the time, I think I have studied that question paper. It's from the digestion chapter only. Just give me 1 second. Yes, Meenakshi, that was from Gudaishan. Yes. Which of the following is correct? Yes. So, you know, I have a question paper. It is of Meenakshi. And please revise all the concept. In next class, we'll again discuss some questions, right? We'll discuss. That will not be a Viva voice or that will not be a test. But still, we are going to discuss some questions and I expect answer from you people. Fine? Should we go ahead?
Yes.
Okay, yes, great. Sir. So, is the Sham is back or not? Sam, are you back? Okay. So today we are going to study the exchange of gases, right? Exchange of gases. So how does the exchange of gases take place? Exchange of gases. First, let me show you some diagram and then we'll exchange respiratory volume we have done. Yes, first we have to study mechanism of respiration. So did we complete it? Mechanism of respiration? No? Yes, not. Mechanism. So before starting exchange of the gases, we have to complete mechanism of respiration, right? So first put the heading, step of respiration. How many steps are there? Steps of respiration. How many steps are there in the respiration process, right? First point. Please note it down. Breathing is inspiration. Breathing is inspiration. First point. Breathing is inspiration and expiration of air. Breathing is inspiration and expiration of air. Expiration of air between atmosphere and alveoli of lungs. Second, diffusion of gases. Diffusion of gases, that is O2 and CO2 takes place. Diffusion of gases, that is O2 and CO2 takes place across the membrane. Diffusion of gases, that is O2 and CO2, takes place across the membrane. Right? Third point. Transport of gases. Transport of gases by blood. Fourth point. Diffusion of O2 and CO2. Diffusion of O2 and CO2 between diffusion of O2 and CO2 between blood and tissue. Diffusion of O2 and CO2 between blood and tissue. Fifth point. Utilization of O2. Utilization of O2 by cells. Utilization of O2 by cells for catabolic reactions and resultant release of CO2 and resultant release of CO2 in cellular respiration. In cellular respiration. Right? So these are the five steps of respiration. Next point is, that is mechanism of respiration, right? So mechanism of respiration. So first I would like to tell you how the inspiration takes place, then I will tell you how the expiration takes place. So what is the mechanism when we breathe in, when we take the gases, right? How does we are able to take the gases inside our body? So I'll tell you. Let me open a PPT for that. how we inhale the gas or how the inspiration takes place. Look, how does the inspiration takes place? Let me explain. Before going in deep into that, I want to tell you something. What are the intercostal muscle? What are the intercostal muscle? And what are the external or internal intercostal muscle? Look, for sake of example, suppose that these are our ribs. So let me draw it. Suppose that these are our ribs. So these are our ribs. The ribs remain interconnected with some muscles. So there are certain muscles which stretch ribs out. This is external intercostal muscle. So whenever these muscles contract, ribs move outward and upward, right? Fine. There are another muscles opposite to them. These muscles. So the remains connected from inside. They are internal intercostal muscle, right? Whenever these internal intercostal muscle contract, ribs come down and inside, inward, right? So look, suppose that if external intercostal muscle will contract, then these internal have to be relaxed. When internal will contract, external will relax, right? If one will contract, then another will go for relaxation. That's how the movement will take place. Now it comes to the process of inhalation. How does we inhale the gas, right? In inhalation process, what happened? The internal intercostal muscle relaxed. So these internal intercostal muscle will relax. Then external, these were, right? So external intercostal muscles will contract. So whenever these external will contract and internal will relax, so what will happen? Rib cage will move upward and outward. Then this is the first point. Then what will happen? This is diaphragm. Diaphragm is a curtain-like structure which separates thoracic cavity from abdominal cavity. Whenever diaphragm comes down, diaphragm contract. So diaphragm contract and flatten. So right now this is in convex shape. When it becomes flattened, then volume increases inside. Volume of thoracic cavity increases. So volume increases. Then the pressure in alveoli decreases. Pressure inside decreases. Then what will happen? The gas will or air will start coming from outside to inside. That's how inhalation will take place. Is it clear to all of you? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. So put the heading, take the screenshot, and now put the heading inspiration. There are one more muscles. These are called abdominal muscles. Abdominal muscles are found in our abdomen, right? So abdominal muscles are found here in our abdominal part, means the stomach part, right? Please note down. First, inspiration. Put the heading inspiration. Inspiration. External intercostal muscle contract and internal get relaxed. Let's stop. They pull the rib and sternum, this mid bone, this one, this mid bone, this mid bone is called sternum, this one is called sternum. So they pull ribs and sternum upward and outward, increasing volume.
So sternum spelling?
Sternum. S-T-U-R-N-U-M. S-T-U-R-N-U-M. We will study this bone in skeletal system.
Sternum upwards and?
Upward and outward.
Yes.
By this way, they increase volume of lungs. Next point. Diaphragm becomes flat and get lowered.
By this way, they increase volume.
By this way, they increase the volume of lungs. Next point. Diaphragm becomes flat and gets lowered by contraction of muscle fiber. Diaphragm becomes flat and gets lowered by contraction of muscle fiber. Next, abdominal muscle relax and allow compression of abdominal organ. Abdominal muscle relax and allow compression of abdominal organ by diaphragm. Next line you have to underline, because this question have already been asked your medical examination. They play passive role in respiration. Underline this. So abdominal muscles play passive role in respiration. Clear all point?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now next heading is exhalation or expiration. Did you make this diagram? This one, external, internal, intercostal muscle. Made?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay, fine. Good. So next is expiration. So let me first open the PPT. Expiration means breathing out. So exhalation or expiration. So first, what happened? Internal intercostal muscle contract. So internal intercostal muscle contract, then obviously external intercostal muscle relax. Now rib cage, because of these muscles, rib cage move downward and inward. Diaphragm get relaxed upward, so it become concave shape. Volume of thoracic cavity means lungs. Volume of thorax means lungs. Thorax is a Latin term, means lungs. Volume of thoracic cavity decreases. Pressure inside alveoli increases. And that's how air moves outward. Clear? So put the heading exhalation or expiration. exhalation or expiration. First, internal intercostal muscle contract. Internal intercostal muscle contract while external get relaxed. Full stop. They pull ribs downward and inward. They pull ribs downward and inward. Full stop. Next point. Diaphragm muscle fiber relax. Diaphragm muscle fiber relax and making it convex. Diaphragm muscle fiber relax and making it convex. Press stop. By this way, they decrease the volume of lungs. Full stop. Next point. Abdominal muscles contract. Abdominal muscle contract. Abdominal muscles contract and pushes. Abdominal muscles contract and pushes.
I can repeat abdominal muscle contract.
Contract and pushes. Diaphragm pushes upward.
So, and pushes?
Diaphragm upward. Pushes diaphragm upward. Full stop. So this was the mechanism of respiration. Is it clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now the next point, next heading is that exchange of gases between alveoli and blood. Exchange of gases between alveoli and blood. So first I will try to make you understand.
Sir, diagram.
Diagram. Okay. Let me show you.
Yes, we're taking the shot.
Okay. So I will tell you I'll show you first diagram. I'll try to make you understand with the help of diagram. Then I'll show you two diagrams. So how does the exchange of gases takes place between the alveoli and look. These are the actually alveoli, right? These are the alveoli. And here the gas is coming from the like bronchioles, right? Bronchioles. So the gas is coming, means oxygen is coming inside. So what will happen? around this surface of, so these are the surface of epithelium, right? This is the epithelial membrane. This is this one. This is epithelial membrane, right? Epithelial membrane. So what will happen? Around the epithelial membrane, there is fine network of blood vessels. And these blood vessels, these are bringing down the carbon dioxide. So these are the blood vessels of veins, right? So veins, they are bringing down the oxygenated blood, and these are the actually arteries, right? So these are the blood vessels. They, what exactly they do, and we'll study deep into like how there is something, a different concept, but we'll study, get into deep when I will explain that is circulation part. So because there, what happened when deoxygenated blood is brought down by the arteries, and oxygenated blood by veins in case of lungs. So that is a different concept. Keep that concept aside right now. So till the time, just try to understand like in broad manner. So these are the epithelial membrane. What happened? These capillaries, these blood vessels, they release carbon dioxide here, and in exchange of that, they will take oxygen and they bring down. That's how the exchange of gases takes place at the surface of alveoli. Is it clear?
Yes.
If clear, take the screenshot. I will show you one more diagram. Taken?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Again. Let me show you another diagram. Look. Now, this is like natural diagram. This is something schematic diagram. So again, what happened? They are blood capillary. These blood vessels, the blue color, it's showing carbon dioxide. These RBC, red blood corpuscles. So these RBC are carrying CO2. So what happened? RBC gives CO2 over here. And this is CO2, RBC gives CO2 over here. And exchange, RBC takes O2 and goes away, right? That's how the exchange takes place. Now, let me make a diagram, and you have to draw that diagram, right? I will hide this part. Okay. I'll draw another diagram over here. Look. So the upper part belongs to alveoli. So in alveoli, there are many surfaces. So first part of alveoli, this is the first membrane of alveoli, right? And this is the first membrane of alveoli. And this is the first, this is called basement membrane. This is called basement membrane. Basement membrane of epithelium. So this is basement membrane. Let me write it more clearly. Epithelium, right? So below the basement membrane, there is one more membrane. Epithelium of alveoli. So let me draw it fat membrane as well. So below the basement membrane, there is one more membrane. So first membrane is our external membrane is basement membrane, and inside there is one more membrane. This is called epithelium of alveoli. Epithelium of inside the epithelium of membrane, right? There is one more rather membrane, I would like to say, that is the part which remains filled with fluid so that it keep lungs moist, right, and hydrated. It do not allow them to stuck. So this part is called fluid and surfactant layer. Fluid and surfactant, right? Again, the lower part this is called basement membrane. This is called again. So basement membrane is over here as well, externally and here as well. So this part which I have shown, these are the three layers of, these all are the three layers of what? Alveoli, right? Now I am going to show you these all three layer of blood capillary, right? This one, right? So this external layer, again, it is made up of basement membrane of capillary, right? So this is again basement membrane. Inside the basement membrane, there is one more layer that is called endothelium layer of capillary, right? So this is the another membrane. So it have only two membrane, not the third membrane is not over here. This is called endothelium layer, right? So there are two layer in this blood capillary and three layer in this alveoli. Why the exchange of gases takes place? How does the exchange of gases, why the exchange of gases take place? That is the question. So look, let me answer you the question. This is RBC. Suppose that this is RBC. This is RBC. Now, why the exchange of gases will take place over here? And how does the exchange of gases will take place? In RBC, the carbon dioxide moves out from RBC to alveoli. Why the carbon dioxide goes out from the RBC to alveoli? Because the CO2 moves away from RBC to alveoli, because the partial pressure of CO2 is 40 mmHg here in alveoli, and partial pressure of CO2 is 45 mmHg in RBC. So what will happen? Diffusion always takes place from higher pressure or higher concentration to lower concentration. So that's why the diffusion of carbon dioxide takes place from RBC to alveoli. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, one more thing. The next is why diffusion of oxygen takes place again. So diffusion of oxygen takes place from alveoli to RBC. Why? Because the diffusion pressure of oxygen in alveoli is 104 mmHg, which is higher than 95 mmHg that is present in the alveoli. So the movement of oxygen takes place from alveoli to RBC. That's how the exchange of gases takes place between the alveoli and RBC or bland cavity. Is it clear or not? Please tell me.
Yes.
Crystal clear to all of you? Please draw the diagram. This is alveoli surface. This is capillary. Please note it down, then please let me know.
No answer.
Okay. And please note it down then. This is very important concept. So underline or make a star rather. Respiratory membrane has a limit of gaseous exchange. Between alveoli. Respiratory membrane has a limit of gaseous exchange between alveoli and pulmonary blood. It is called
between alveoli
and pulmonary blood. It is called diffusing capacity. Underline diffusing capacity. It is called diffusing capacity. Full stop. Next point. The diffusing capacity is defined. The diffusing capacity is defined as volume of gases that diffuses through membrane per minute. For a pressure difference of 1 mmHg. Next, make a star. It is question for your medical. Actually, the question from this line have been asked already. diffusion of CO2 is 20 times faster than O2. Diffusion of CO2 is 20 times faster than O2. And that of O2 is 2 times faster than N2. And that of O2 is 2 times faster than N2. That is nitrogen. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now the next heading is, so please tell me, is it crystal clear to all of you? The exchange of gases? Okay. So next part is, that is a transport of gases, right? So put the heading, transport of O2 in blood. Please take the screenshot. I'm going to remove this slide. Okay. When I will remove this slide, this part will erased. This part will be permanently erased. Right. So please take the screenshot.
Yes, sir. Done.
Done. Okay. I'm going to remove it. Atif, all clear?
Yes, sir.
Great. Okay. So the first heading is the transport of O2 in blood. Please note it down. About 3% of O2 in the blood is dissolved in the plasma. And plasma carry this O2 to body cell. So what about the 97%, rest of the 97%? So 1% of CO2 is transported with the help of blood plasma. It remains in dissolved condition and it provides this oxygen, which is dissolved in plasma, to the rest of the tissue which require it. Rest 97% of O2, it travels inside the RBC in the form of HbO2. That is oxyhemoglobin, right? So note it down. 97% of O2 is dissolved with hemoglobin in form of oxyhemoglobin. In form of oxyhemoglobin. And carried to body cells. Next. When oxygenated blood reaches to different tissues, the partial pressure of O2 declines. When oxygenated blood reaches to different tissues, the partial pressure of O2 declines. and the bond holding oxygen to hemoglobin becomes unstable. As a result, oxygen is released from blood capillaries.
Unstable.
As a result, oxygen is released from blood capillaries. To tissues. Look what happens. Suppose that this is RBC. So RBC have hemoglobin, oxyhemo HbO2. So there is a temporary bond between hemoglobin and oxygen. So what happened? So when it reaches to tissues, the partial pressure decline because they have low oxygen partial pressure, and here they have high oxygen partial pressure. So what happened here? The partial pressure of oxygen declines. So this bond become weakened and this bond breaks down. When this bond breaks down, the oxygen move from here to here, right? So that's how they leave the oxygen in the tissues, right? The next point is a note, right? Again, the question have been asked from this concept. So please put a note and write the next point in the note. A normal person have about 15 gram of hemoglobin. 15 gram of hemoglobin per 100 ml of blood. A normal person have 15 gram of hemoglobin just a minute. Please give me 1 second. I want to recheck concept.
Sir, approximately how much blood do a normal person have?
5.5 liters.
Okay.
And the weight of the person is 70 kg, a healthy person with the weight of 70 kg, and that will be the men, okay. Not women, right? I think it should be milligram. That's why I'm confused. Let me cross check it. Right, it's correct. It's correct. Keep on writing. So a normal person has about 15 gram of hemoglobin per 100 ml of blood. 15 gram of hemoglobin. So whenever somebody asks you what is your blood report, you say that hemoglobin is normal. It is 13, it is 14. Right, so average the hemoglobin should be 14, male or female. A normal person has 15 gram of hemoglobin per 100 ml of blood. Full stop. 1 gram of hemoglobin bind. 1 gram of hemoglobin bind about. 1 gram of hemoglobin bind about 1.3 ml. 1 gram of hemoglobin bind about 1.34 ml of O2. Full stop. Thus, on an average, 100 ml of blood, 100 ml of blood carries 19.4 ml of O2. Keep the data in your mind. The question has been asked from this concept. Now the next topic is, so transport of O2 clear? How did the transport of O2 take place? So transport of O2 takes place only in two forms. First, 3% in plasma form, and second, in form of HbO2. But transport of carbon dioxide is a bit tricky. So transport of carbon dioxide is a bit complex. So because this takes place in three ways: in plasma, in hemoglobin, and in bicarbonate ion form, right? So the third part is we need to understand, right? So is it clear? Transport of O2 clear, all of you?
Yes, sir.
So next heading is transport of CO2. Next heading is transport of CO2. Transport of CO2. Now, how does the transport of CO2 take place? First, because of blood plasma, na? Blood plasma. Is not at all. Because of its high solubility, about 7% of, because of its high solubility, 7% of CO2 get dissolved in blood plasma, and is carried in solution form to lungs. Next, transport of CO2 as bicarbonate ion.
Sir, plasma does, right?
Yes. Plasma. Now, transport of CO2 in form of bicarbonate ion, HCO3-, right? Now, this is the thing which I need to make you understand. Please try to understand what I am going to explain.
The plasma transports the CO2 into lungs in the form of bicarbonate.
Right. Now, what happens? Suppose that, please try to understand what I am telling you. Suppose that this is the blood capillary wall. This is the wall of blood capillary. So this is blood capillary wall. This is blood capillary wall. And suppose that this is tissue. So from where it have to take CO2? Tissue, or you can say cell or tissue. From you have to take CO2. And for sake of example, this is RBC inside blood capillary. Yes, this is RBC. So what will happen? It will take carbon dioxide from here to RBC, right? So carbon dioxide is taken from, and why it is taken, we have understood, right? Because of partial pressure, difference in the pressure, right? So what will happen? Carbon dioxide will come from here to here. Now, what happened? inside the plasma, inside the protoplasm of RBC, there is water. Water combined with this, carbon dioxide. And after that, it forms an unstable compound that is called carbonic acid, H2CO3. So formation of carbonic acid takes place. Carbon dioxide plus H2O, and there is an enzyme. I will tell you the name of the enzyme, that is carbonic anhydrase. I will tell you, right? So what happened? It combines with carbonic acid. Carbonic acid is an unstable compound. Now what happens? This carbonic acid will break down. Again, the carbonic acid will break down into bicarbonate ion and S plus. What will happen? This break down into HCO3 minus and plus hydrogen, right? The hydrogen. What happened? The walls of these membrane, they have a particular type of channel, right? Gateway or channel. So it has particular type of gateway or channel. So what happened? What these gateway or channel do? They're actually a type of antiport. What actually they do, they take away these extra bicarbonate ion. So bicarbonate ion goes out. In exchange with the bicarbonate ion, chloride comes inside, right? And in the meantime, this hydrogen ion, it combined with hemoglobin, right? This H ion combined with hemoglobin. And it forms HHB, right? This phenomena that the action that when the phenomena, this is the antiport, right? Antiport, this bring out the bicarbonate ion and bring in the chloride ion. This phenomena is called chloride shift. Or this is also known as the question which has been asked in your medical examination. The question was, what is the Hamburger effect? This, the same phenomena which is called chloride shift, is also known as Hamburger effect. Hamburger effect or Hamburger phenomenon. This is called Hamburger effect or Hamburger, right? Because of the entry of chloride, this RBC swell up and the volume of RBC also, that is the side effect of this, right? Okay. So, did you got the chloride shift?
Yes, sir, 50-50.
One more important thing which you need to note it down, that this carbon dioxide combines with water, right? And this combines with the water. And as we have studied, that is the reversible change. And it gets converted, here we have studied, into HTCO3. And we say that H2CO3 is carbonic acid. The enzyme which is responsible for it is carbonic anhydrase. So this reaction takes place in presence of carbonic anhydrase. Again, as I have told you that it is an unstable compound, so H2CO3, it breaks down into bicarbonate ion and hydrogen. So what happened? Right. Again, in presence of carbonic anhydrase, it breaks down into HCO3 minus plus hydrogen, right? So this is the bicarbonate. Is it clear? how does the transport of takes place, transport of carbon dioxide takes place in the form of bicarbonate. Is it clear to all of you? Meenakshi, clear? Tamara?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Please note it down. Please note it down and let me know.
Yes,
so everybody note it down.
1 second.
Yeah, please.
So what is the second row? H, the second row. CO2, down of CO2 in the circle, sir.
Circle, this one. This one.
Yeah, circle, second row.
Second row, circle. This one.
Oh, yes, sir.
This hydrogen ion. Hydrogen ion, this is hemoglobin.
Hemoglobin, okay. Then the one.
And they make HHB.
Oh, okay, sir. HHB.
Write down the reaction as well.
Yes, sir. That
okay. Start writing now. The largest fraction of, so heading is transport of CO2 as bicarbonate ion, right? Transport of CO2 as, the second point is transport of CO2 as a bicarbonate ion, right? The largest fraction of CO2 that is about 70%. Largest fraction of CO2, that is about 70%, is converted into bicarbonate ion, is converted into bicarbonate ion, and transported in plasma. Full stop. When CO2 diffuses into RBC. When CO2 diffuses into RBC, it combines with water and form carbonic acid. Next point.
And form
carbonic acid, H2CO3. And form carbonic acid, H2CO3. Full stop. Next point. H2CO3 is unstable compound. H2CO3 is unstable compound and quickly dissociate into bicarbonate ion and hydrogen ion. Full stop. The liberated hydrogen ion causes, that is very important point, underline please. The liberated hydrogen ion causes little change in the pH value under resting condition. Hence, the blood become slightly more acidic. Please stop. The pH value declined from 7.4 to 7.34. The pH value declined from 7.4 to 7.34. Right? Next. Fluoride shift, next heading is inside the same subheading. Next subheading is inside the bicarbonate ion. Subheading is chloride shift or Hamburger effect. Chloride shift or Hamburger effect. About 70% of bicarbonate ion formed in red cells.
So about 70% of
70% of bicarbonate ion formed in RBC. These 70%. 70% of this one. This 70% goes out and the 30% remains inside. About 70% of bicarbonate ion formed in RBC enters the plasma. Full stop. The excess of bicarbonate ion leaves RBC in exchange for chloride ion. In exchange of chloride ion. Let's talk. The exchange, is called, the exchange is called chloride shift. Consequently, the RBC takes up water and its size increases. Right? Clear bicarbonate ion form and chloride shift Hamburger effect. Crystal clear to all of you?
Yes.
Okay. Next point. So 7% through here, right? 70% here, right? So now it is 77. How does the 23 rest of the 23% CO2 is transported? So rest of the 23% CO2 is transported in the form of, with the help of hemoglobin, right? So third. So third is transport of CO2 as carboaminohemoglobin. As carboaminohemoglobin. Right? So note it down. So CO2 plus Hb, the reversible phenomenon, HbCO2. And HbCO2 is called carboaminohemoglobin. Note it down. Every 100 ml of blood deliver approximately 4 ml of CO2 to alveoli. Right? Okay. So this RBC have taken carbon dioxide from tissue. It has taken 7% in form of plasma, 70% in bicarbonate ion, and rest in the combination with the hemoglobin. Now this will take away the carbon dioxide to the alveoli. How does it release the carbon dioxide to alveoli? So that is our next topic. So next topic is, put the heading, release of CO2 in alveoli. How does it release CO2 in alveoli? Like, so let me explain you. So suppose that this is the RBC. This is our RBC. Right, and here you have the surface of alveoli or the wall of alveoli. These are the alveoli. This is the surface of it. So how does it do? So again, when look. Put it and let me make the alveoli. So these are alveoli. Now what happened? Oxygen comes from here to here. And what happened? So we have already understood that the HHB is present inside the cell, right? Inside the RBC. So what will happen? This oxygen will break this bond, HHB, and After this, what will happen? Hydrogen ion will be released, and again the hemoglobin get separated. So hemoglobin, they will get separated. And after this separation, what will happen? The port will become, start moving opposite. Because of this, what will happen? Now the antiport will again start moving oppositely. When they reaches to the alveoli or lungs, this antiport will start moving in different way. Now the bicarbonate ion HCO3 negative will start coming inside, and chloride ion will go outside. So what will happen? These HCO3 come inside. So this HCO3, when this HCO3 will come inside, the bicarbonate ion will come inside. Again, they will combine with these hydrogen ion, right? And after the combination of these hydrogen ion, what will happen? They will again form H2CO3. H2CO3 in presence of bicarbonate, in presence of carbonic anhydrase, in presence of carbonic anhydrase, it will break down into H2O plus CO2. What will happen? The CO2 will be released into here in alveoli. That's how the RBC gives CO2 to alveoli. Clear or not? Clear?
Yes.
Samira, clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Please note it down, make it, and then write it down. And this is also known as Haldane effect. Haldane effect. It was discovered by J.S. Haldane. He was from Scotland, a Scottish scientist.
Done, sir.
Done?
1 second, sir.
Sure.
Done.
Okay. Binding of O2, please write down. Binding of O2 with hemoglobin. Binding of O2 with hemoglobin tends to displace CO2. Binding of O2 with hemoglobin tends to displace CO2 from the blood. This is called Haldane effect. This is called Haldane effect. Discovered by G.S. Haldane and a Scottish scientist. Next point. When hemoglobin of the lungs, blood capillary take up O2.
So when the hemoglobin of the lungs,
blood capillaries takes up O2, comma, the hydrogen ion are released from it. Please stop. Then chloride released from the RBC and bicarbonate ion comes back to RBC. Please stop.
Bicarbonate
ion comes back to RBC. Next point. After this, bicarbonate ion, react with carbonic acid.
After this bicarbonate ion
bicarbonate ion react with hydrogen ion.
Sir, after this bicarbonate and carbonic acid react with?
No. After this bicarbonate ion react with this reaction. Hydrogen ion and form carbonic acid, comma, carbonic acid split into water and CO2 in presence of carbonic anhydrase. By this way,
so in presence of a
carbonic anhydrase enzyme. By this way, CO2 goes to lungs. All clear?
Yes, sir.
Next class, I will tell you neural control of respiration. Put the heading and you have to tell me what we have to study.
Sure.
Neural control